Hey fellas, welcome back to part 2 of this series on how to design your own cabin. Today we're gonna size the floor and wall framing. We're gonna look at the footings and how we can brace the structure. And as I mentioned in part 1, if you haven't watched part 1, go back and watch it first. I'm using the tables from AS1684. However, if you have a preferred timber manufacturer, you can also use their tables for their specific products. Also, a little advice for young engineers: if you're just starting out in the profession, have these tables on hand so that you can compare the results from the software you're using or any hand calculation you're doing to the values that these tables will give you, and then avoid making mistakes. So having said that, let's get started. So we're gonna start sizing FJ1, which are the floor joists at the bathroom. There are no roof loads. It's a continuous span and they are spaced at 450 millimeter centers. Each span is 1800, but instead of using 90 by 35, which is what the table gives us, I will choose 90 by 45, just in case we use a heavier flooring material for the bathroom. So theoretically, FJ2 should be the same size as FJ1, but we're gonna upsize it so that we can achieve a wet area set down. So you want that that set down between the bathroom floor and the floor in the rest of the house, obviously. Deck joists are single span, 1300, which would give us 70 by 35, but since decks have higher live loads, I will upsize that to 90 by 45, which also gives us a 50 millimeter step from the internal to the external area. So we've got so the water doesn't get in if you have the step from the balcony to the house. And remember that every member exposed to the weather should be H3 treated and painted. Or you can use a hardwood timber. So next we're going to design the floor beams and deck beams, starting from the intermediate FB1. It's a continuous pan floor beam. 1800 span. Floor load width is 1800, so we get that the FB1 is a double 90 by 35. The perimeter FB1, I'm just naming the same because in the end I want to use the same size throughout, but we could get different results here. The only difference from the perimeter one is that they've got a load bearing wall with roof load on top. So because you've got the external walls on top of this perimeter beam. The floor load width is 900. The roof load width is 1800. And it's a continuous span. Same deal. We're gonna get a double 90 by 45. I'm assuming you guys know what the floor load width and roof load width means, right? The tributary, sort of a tributary area. That DB1 has a floor load width of 1800 divided by 2 plus 1300 divided by 2 equals 1550. The roof load width is 1800 plus 1300 divided by 2, and that works out to be 2450. It's also a continuous span. So just looking at the table for a continuous span, roof load width, we're gonna get a double 120 by 35 MGP12. That could potentially be a single 190 by 35, for example. And to make size uniform, we're just gonna standardize everything. I'm gonna make FB1 the same size as DB1. And don't forget that if the beam is exposed to the weather, same deal, H3 treated and painted, or hardwood. So next we're going to design the studs in the wall framing. And we're going to look at the worst case scenario, which is the front wall. The front wall has a roof load width of 1800 plus 1300 divided by 2. The height of the studs are 2.4 meters. They're spaced at every 450 centers, and they've got noggings at 1.35 meters high. Just drawing the noggings here. That's what noggings are, they're sort of blockings. So looking at this table, we've got rafters spaced at 900 centers. We are using metal sheet roof. The studs are spaced at 450 centers. And that gives us 70 by 35 studs. So studs 70 by 35 and should be 12 at 450 centers. Now the top plate connects the rafters to the studs, and that's the location of the top plates. And following this table, assuming we will have M12 rods tied down at 1200 centers, or it could also be at 1800 centers, we get that the top plate is 70 by 35 MGP12, so it's the same size as the stud, but the top plates are laid flat. Bottom plate, same procedure. Just go to the table. We're gonna get the same size as well. So bottom plates, rafter, spaced at 900, metal sheet roof. Same, 70 by 35, MGP12. Jump studs, they are the studs adjacent to openings. And looking at the worst case scenario, L3 is 3 meters with a roof load width of 2450. That's the worst case scenario. We just gonna do this one, and you do the other ones. Looking at the table, we get that we need double 70 by 35 MGP12. So at every opening, just double up the studs, okay? Now we're gonna work out the racking force that the bracings need to resist. We have already determined the wind classification, which is N2. We will determine the wind pressure, the area of elevation, and the racking force in kilonewtons. So the width of the cabin is 3.6 meters. The bracing walls need to resist the pressure on the upper half windward wall. Okay, windward wall is the wall that the wind's gonna blow. The wind's hitting that wall, it means it's the windward wall. So the area of elevation is 3.6 meters times 1.2 meters equal to 4.32 meters squared. Now the ultimate strength pressure, which is the wind pressure that we're going to use, can be found on AS 4055 table 3.3 for any two at any position. We get a 0.86 kPa of pressure on the wall. If we multiply the area of elevation, multiply an area by the pressure, we get a force, right? Because it's meter squared times kilonewtons per meter squared. Cancel. We got kilonewtons. And that's the force that all the ply bracings need to resist this force in that direction. Now the same principle applies to the length of the cabin. We need to find the area of elevation of the upper half of the windward wall. So the area of elevation is 1.2 meters times 11 meters. So that's the tributary area. We get 13.2 times the pressure, we're going to get a force in kilonewtons, 11.35 kilonewtons in the other direction. So we've got 3.7 in one direction, 11.35 in the other direction. So let's assume that each ply has a capacity of 6 kilonewtons per meter. I'm going to start placing plies at every corner. So 0.6 here, 0.9 there. And what we're going to do, we're going to call this direction A, the direction from where the 3.7 kilonewtons is, we're going to call it direction A. We're just going to add up all the ply bracing that we've got and multiply that by the capacity of the ply bracing. That will give us a total capacity, bracing capacity in that direction. That's 24 kilonewtons. That's way beyond 3.7 kilonewtons. Okay, so we're covered. We're easy. Same thing for the other direction. I'm just gonna place ply bracings on the corners, one in the middle in the kitchen here, and I'm gonna call it direction B. That gives us pretty much same 25 kilonewtons, which is way greater than 11.35. So let's have a look at the footings now. We'll be using 350 millimeters diameter board piers with the minimum depth of 600 millimeters. So it's going to be 600 into the soil. Every timber post will be cast into the concrete, and I'll show you the details later. So for the downward force, the gravity loads, each footing will have to support a tributary area of 1.8 meters times 1.8 meters. That's equal to 3.24 meters squared. If we multiply this area by the dead load and then plus the live load, we're gonna get the force that the board pier needs to resist. The area of the pier is pi times 0.35 squared divided by 4. And that's simple maths, right? Pressure equals to force divided by area, 6.5 divided by 0.096, and we get the bearing capacity of the soil. So most natural soils can achieve 70 kPa, so you will be fine if you put your board pier in the natural soil. So designing for lateral loads now, pretty much the same process, area of elevation, but the footings and for the poles, the area of elevation is going to be the whole wall, not only the upper half. So you need to work out the area of the whole wall. So the area times the wind pressure, we get a racking force. Same thing, okay, 0.86 times 8.64. We get a force of 7.43. kilonewtons in the direction A. Same calculations will apply to this side of the cabin now. The area of elevation is 11 times 2.4 meters. Remember, it's the whole wall now, it's not only the upper half wall. And wind pressure times area gives us a force, okay? And that's the racking force, 0.86 times 26.4. We get the force that all our piers together will have to resist in the direction B. So the lateral capacitor of the pier and post can be found on table 8.10 of AS1684. The height above the ground is 400 millimeters. The pier depth will be 600 and the diameter 350. So this will result in a capacity of 4.2 kilonewtons for each pier. So each pier can resist 4.2 kilonewtons lateral loads. So we're going to work out the capacity in each direction, which is the number of piers times the capacity of each pier, right? And you will notice that we have way more resisting force than we actually need, 117. It's a lot. That's the detail of the structure of your cabin. So if you're building it, it should pretty much look like this detail or similar. You need M12 bolts to the posts, to the beams. You need triple grips from the studs to the rafters, joists to beams. Your timber post will be cast into the concrete. You've got 600, your footing should be 600 deep into natural soil. And that's pretty much it. You've got the step from the outside to the inside. Looks, it's pretty easy. And I hope you learned something with this video. If you have any questions, just drop a comment below. I'll be more than happy to answer your questions. And I'll see you in the next video.